Going to talk a little bit about how to write your personal statement of purpose for the College of Engineering undergraduate majors. And if you're not familiar with this process, what we're going to go through is going to hopefully show you a little bit more about the criteria that the College of Engineering is looking for, as well as some tips for creating strong content and writing tips, how to write well, overall thoughts that you want to consider for good writing and good grammar and some of those things. And then we'll also address some good next steps and resources to help you build a very strong personal statement of purpose. Let's talk a little bit about the criteria first. It's important to know your deadlines before we dive into some of this. So if you're not familiar, feel free to use these links to go ahead and visit this website, which tells you a little bit about all the deadlines that are coming up and exactly what the admissions process looks like for that particular semester. Typically, you're going to be scheduling an appointment with the testing center to write your personal statement of purpose, and this is usually done early in the semester as you're going through the application process. To see all of those dates, use these two websites, and then to schedule with the testing center, you'll use that bottom link. Do so early, though. A lot of times they will fill up, especially those that are closer to the end when you need to have your personal statement of purpose completed. So these are the three questions that you're asked as you're writing your personal statement of purpose. Keep these in mind. You can access those on that website that was on the previous slide, but you'll notice that there are some word counts associated with each one. Those are really to help guide you as you write your two pages, which we'll talk a little bit more about all the criteria that you need to meet in just a moment. But you want to write about a third for each one of these. And a little bit more time should be spent on that last one about why the College of Engineering can help you reach your career goals. So these are the questions, and we'll talk about how you can kind of incorporate these when we get to some tips about writing your content. But just know this is what you're asked to write about. You do get asked to write two pages double-spaced. It's 12-point font, Times New Roman, and this is 30% of your score for admissions. So you do want to spend the time to really craft something strong, memorize an outline, and be able to bring that into the testing center and write a strong statement of purpose. The three things that the readers are going to be looking at as far as scoring you are listed in those bottom three bullets. We've got content and creativity. So is your content saying what it needs to say, and is it doing so a little bit differently? Oftentimes, storytelling is a good way to accomplish this, which we will talk about in just a little bit. Style, expression, and execution. So are you being effective in the way that you're communicating? Is your style something that is unique? Is your writing good? So this has to do a lot with some of the writing tips we'll cover. And then overall effectiveness relates somewhat to those other two, but overall, are you getting across the points that you want to? And are you really addressing the questions that you're supposed to address? So as I said, this is that timed writing session. You get 2 hours, which for most students tends to be a good bit of time. So you shouldn't be too rushed, but you do want to plan accordingly. You can do typed or handwritten. It's up to you. I would say probably lean towards the typed, because oftentimes you don't want anyone, because if your handwriting is a little messy or you're in a rush, you don't want anyone to misread that. So I'd probably encourage you to stick with the typed. And developing a plan, because you do have that time limit and because you get the prompt ahead of time, is really important. You're not allowed to bring anything in with you to the testing center. So when we talk about some things, it is encouraged for you to write out your statement ahead of time so you know what you want to say, so you understand how long and how much space it's going to take. But the only thing you can bring in is what you have memorized. So an outline is really crucial. Usually a lot of students will maybe memorize an outline. So when they go in, they have a plan of what they're going to write, and they've already written it out before. So they're able to kind of work through that and hopefully do just that two pages that you need to do for this statement. And then make sure you definitely save time. Usually 20 minutes or 30 minutes is good for revisions and review. And if you have extra time, great, you can use that as well. But make sure that you do plan according to that 2 hour time limit. Next, we have content. So let's dig into some tips for actually developing strong content. One of those is to tell your story, which I kind of already mentioned. Stories help to check that box of creativity, and they are usually really memorable, which is why that's something that can help make you stand out. It gives your reason usually for why do you want to be an engineer? Why are you interested in pursuing this degree? And it can help because it's usually something more specific and tangible, and it can showcase who you are as a person, which is really good to do. So I would encourage you to think of stories that help to really prove your points that you want to make. Quantifying your stories is helpful too, because this paints a clear picture of what you're discussing. So let's say that you're interested in working in maybe the automotive industry. Maybe you're applying to mechanical engineering or even another major in the college. This particular person, let's say they had just said, "We worked for a while, but my grandfather and I restored an older car with a lot of different parts." That's okay, but it doesn't really paint as clear of a picture as this one, which is saying that it took 2 years, they restored an almost 70-year-old car with over 200 parts. So that's a very different and much better picture because of some of the numbers and details that are there. So keep that in mind with your storytelling. How can you paint that clear picture with some descriptors or with some numbers? Another great thing to consider is, what are those great qualities that you bring to the table? If you're unsure, I would encourage you to write down a list of adjectives that describe yourself, whether it's that you're detail-oriented or you're a great problem solver. Think of some of those characteristics that you have and jot those down. If you're having a hard time coming up with these, it's great to ask family and friends who know you well, who can maybe help you add to this list. And this can be just about your character. It might be your attitude, your personality. Oftentimes, too, you want to convey your intelligence through the way that you talk about this and through having good writing. And then you do want to be sure to use jargon appropriately. That's just a good tip overall. If you're talking about some engineering experience that you have and some qualities that you have that relate to that, great. But don't overuse jargon. Oftentimes the people who may be reviewing this are going to be PhD students in English, and oftentimes they're not very familiar with all the jargon of engineering. They're looking more at those three scoring criteria that we saw earlier. So make sure that you keep in mind your audience and you're not trying to overuse jargon. You're really just trying to tell your story and answer those three questions really well. The last tip on here is a great one. Make sure you address any problems. So let's say that you have something that is in another part of your application, or maybe you don't have a ton of engineering related experience. That's okay, but make sure you kind of discuss some reasons for that. Don't discuss excuses for it. That's something that's not really going to help your cause. What you want to focus on more is just give those reasons and then focus more on how you have learned from that particular problem or issue, or maybe not a great grade, and maybe what you learned from it, how you took away some positive things and made good changes based on that. These are three really good components that the questions actually really cover well, and you want to make sure these are kind of included as you start thinking of ideas of what to put in your personal statement of purpose. Motivation is the first one. This is really just why you want to do this. Why are you interested in pursuing this as a career option? And then the next kind of builds on that, the fit capacity. How do you know this is going to be the right career for you? How do you know that you're going to be successful in this and even in the College of Engineering in the major that you chose? This can be where those characteristics really come into play, right? So that problem solving one that we mentioned, you could bring this in and tell a story about how you have problem solved in the past and how that's going to help you succeed in your chosen major in the College of Engineering. And then vision, how do you want to impact the profession? This is kind of the goals piece. That question about the career aspiration is a good one to think about with this. What kind of impact do you want to make? It could be very specific. It could be, I want to work in aerospace and I want to do these very specific things in this job. But it could also be broad. It could be that maybe you're unsure of the exact route that you want to take, but you know that you want to contribute to the public good through something that you do in civil engineering or through research that you do in biological engineering. So regardless of what it is, if it's broad or specific, try to give what you can about it. Try to talk about the characteristics of what you're looking for to help make that clear to your reader. This is a great activity just to walk away from this, or you can even just hit pause and try this. But I would encourage you to draw a road. Grab a piece of paper that's blank and just draw a road on it. It can be straight, it can be curvy, all over the place. It can have a fork in it. It's totally up to you. And what this road represents is just kind of your story, where you've come from and where you are right now, and then where you're going. And I would encourage you to not necessarily look at these questions first, but start with just writing some highlights along your journey on that blank piece of paper. This could be words, it could be phrases. You could draw pictures if you like to draw. It's all about kind of what you want to envision. And then once you've done that, come back to these questions and think about how do the things that you've written or drawn relate to some of the prompts that you're given. Take some time to do that just to help you start brainstorming ideas. That can be a really good activity to kind of get things started. Let's talk a little bit about some writing tips, because after you've gone through some of this and hopefully brainstormed some ideas based on the prompts, based on some of the things that we discussed, you're going to get to the point where you actually do need to think about the writing itself. So you do want to start and end strong. That's a really good tip, is really focus on where you start and where you end. And you want to be concise. Try not to be too wordy. And honestly, you've only got 2 pages, so you can't really afford to be too wordy. As you're doing that, you do want to pick and choose your words pretty carefully. So oftentimes people try to use a lot of adjectives, but because you have only so many pages and only so many words, it's oftentimes better to use really active nouns and verbs, and then just use those adjectives or adverbs that describe some of those things a little more carefully. You do want to make sure you use some transitional words, phrases, or sentences so that it's easy for the reader to follow along with your different ideas and thoughts. You don't want it to just be kind of a scrambled mess of a bunch of different stories, because that can be really hard for someone to read. And then you want to stay away from cliches, like things like, "I've always wanted to be an engineer since I was born." Even though that may be your case, where you feel like you've really loved engineering for a long time, it's better to show some snippets and some highlights of stories along the way that showcase that you have been involved in engineering for a while, or you've had that love of engineering for a while. Intro, body, conclusion is a good general format. Just know that your intro may not be an entire paragraph. You may have a couple of introductory sentences before you start diving into and answering some of the prompts, and your conclusion may be the same way. You might have some summarizing sentences, but it may not be an entire paragraph. Peel is a great format to follow, and if you think back to your high school English classes, this is going to probably sound pretty familiar to you. All this is how do you structure and set up a paragraph? And so essentially what it's telling you is you're going to start with the point. What is the topic sentence of that body paragraph? What is the point that you want the reader to take away? You want to give some evidence and explanation, so you're really backing up that point, giving some evidence and some things that say, here's why this is relevant to you as the reader, here's why this is relevant to the College of Engineering. And then the final piece is that transitional sentence. So this will help you link what you just discussed to the next paragraph and the next point that you want to make. This is a great structure to follow and keep in mind, whether you're in the testing center kind of using this to make sure you're having clear paragraphs, or as you're writing your draft before you ever go in, so that you have a good concept of how each of your points is going to play out. Let's think about a couple of next steps. So if you walk away from this video, hopefully you have a couple new ideas, but you may still need some help. And it's good to start revising and start thinking about your content. Put it all on paper, but then get help from people on campus so that you're really able to make sure you're addressing those questions well. So the Career Center is a great place to start. You're welcome to come visit us. I'll give you our information in just a little bit. The Writing Center, DAE, some of those are good resources as well. Faculty can also be really helpful if you have some faculty. Someone who knows you well is great to say, this really sounds like your voice. This tells me your story. Someone who doesn't know you well could be someone at the Career Center, but that's a person who can say, I do or don't have enough context, or maybe I need more clarification on this one particular part of the prompt that you're given. So really make sure you get some good advice and feedback from different people, and these are great sources to start with. These are two great links just to know about and two great on-campus places for you to get your personal statement of purpose reviewed. So the College of Engineering has some great experiential learning staff. And if you go to that website, you can view it there. And then the Career Center also has a lot of staff members who can help you with your revisions and make sure you're on the right track. These are the ways to kind of get plugged in there as far as appointments or drop-in hours, which are usually more quick appointments. So regardless of where you are with your personal statement of purpose, I hope this has given you some new ideas, but please feel free to access some of these resources to get more help on your personal statement of purpose.